United Nations agency UNESCO says artificial intelligence has the potential to address some of the biggest challenges in education today, but it needs safeguards and regulations from governments.
Let's talk about that with Dr. Margarita Ballesteros, Director 4 at the Philippine Education Department. And joining us in the studio, Francis Jim Toscano, EdTech Coordinator at Xavier School San Juan. He's also a digital learning and innovation consultant. Director Marge, good to see you on Zoom.
Hi, good evening, Salve, and to your colleague. Hi, Jim.
Hi there.
Yes, welcome to the studio, Jim. This has been a topic that we've wanted to talk about here in Business Outlook, because we've been talking about AI a lot in because of the context of a lot of different corporations in different industries wanting to use that to improve, of course, their bottom lines. But before that goes there, children and students in schools need to learn about AI first and know how to use it. Director Marge, is there something that's already set in the Department of Education on how AI or ChatGPT can be either a friend or foe in the classrooms?
For now, with the new curriculum, well, the technology integration is there. Jim knows this very well, being an EdTech expert. But for the use of the AI, that's one thing that we still need to look into. But of course, we know for a fact as adults, we know the benefits on the use of it. With ChatGPT, as we have started talking about it last time when we were in that event with RCBC for the DiscarTech workshop, if I remember it right, we personally, I told you that I don't have anything against ChatGPT because it's helpful and it is something that we need to learn to get used to it and ask help. But of course, with all the ethical standards, if I may put it that way, we also need to get to know which ones are really worth mentioning or taking, but we are accountable for the use of all of these things. Because in ChatGPT, you can actually return back what you have done. ChatGPT provides it, and then you try to look into it if that fits what you're looking at, and then again return it to ChatGPT again, and for it to get to fix it again, and you fix it again. So the person who's using it, myself personally, in my experience, it's actually helpful, beneficial, especially so that we are asked to do things. I mean, we are asked to prepare a number of things right away when you are asked to speak of something. And at the same time, you are asked to with Jim here, who can vouch for me, when you prepare a brief, article for something that you are asked to react on or to submit in the grad school, wherein you can do a bit of tweaking and you can inject whatnot or what kind of things that you still want to get to be included. But ChatGPT, for me, I must say, is helpful. It only depends on how it is used and how teachers manage to teach the students on how to make use of it.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I can sense you wanting to jump in.
I want to ask something from Jim. Being an educator, you were a teacher at Xavier. You're a director for EdTech now. I'm just curious, from your point of view as an educator, should schools be teaching AI to kids already, or are they even prepared to teach about AI and new technologies in schools already?
Yeah, I think that's a very valid question. Before we can even talk about AI, I think it's important to look at our digital curriculum because AI, like what I've said a while ago, AI has so many, it's a big umbrella term. There's generative AI, there are strong AI. Our phones, our laptops are doing AI works behind the scene, and that was not a problem before. I think the main idea right now is that the accessibility of generative AI like ChatGPT. So there are some debates right now. I think what is important to us about it, about that question is, are we ready in terms of allowing the students? For example, I teach in grade school. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So ChatGPT should not be accessible to grade school students because they have age restrictions. But you know, that's ideal.
That's
in real
30,
life.
Right? Yeah. That's 13, 0 to 13 yeah. should not be able to.
Yeah, and if you're below 18 and 18 to 13, you need parental consent for that.
Yeah.
I think more than using AI, like for example, generative AI, I think we need to go back to the basic idea of digital learning skills, yeah. like you know, using your laptops for what is good, digital well-being as well, protecting yourself right. in terms of privacy and safety. And I just want to be very candid. I use ChatGPT. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If I have a memo to send, uh-huh. I just ask ChatGPT to create that for me.
We should have asked ChatGPT what to
questions.
Ask you.
I think you guys on the media industry, mm-hmm. you're actually one of those mm-hmm. very endangered by ChatGPT, along with teachers as well. Uh-huh. In terms of curriculum, using AI tools might work because the goal of a lot of AI companies, their goal is to empower human beings mm-hmm. to use AI tools, mm-hmm. not to really replace us. Can you try to go back to history, for example, graphing calculators
yeah.
or calculators themselves? There was a big discussion before. It might reduce numeracy skills, mm-hmm. but we've learned to live with it.
So that
right?
sounds like mm-hmm. a soft no to Ron's question mm-hmm. on whether we are now or we should be able to teach AI or ChatGPT to
it's a matter
kids.
Of readiness. It's a matter
a
of readiness.
Matter of readiness.
It's a matter of readiness for me because there are a lot of nuancing.
Mm-hmm.
Like for example, I'm a student. When I lift something from ChatGPT, I ask a question. Lifting verbatim, that could be plagiarism. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, but when you use ChatGPT deeper, it could be a personal assistant.
Yeah.
My school
yeah.
does not have a budget for me to have a personal assistant, right? A secretary, uh-huh. but
you could get it to transcribe for you, for example.
Write memo, check grammars of, you know, of memos or whatever. So, depending on the level of use, that's how we want to teach kids right now. But I would focus more on skills,
mm-hmm.
Critical thinking skills, because you're getting information.
Mm-hmm.
So the tools can, you know. They vary, they get changed all the time. You have new models here and there.
Yeah.
But those skills, like critical thinking, evaluative skills in terms of information, those are long-lasting skills.
That's a lot to unpack, Director March. Going back to you, Director March, I think we've had this very interesting conversation off-cam about if you're asking ChatGPT, only you can ask those questions. So in effect, the way ChatGPT answers you or any other, it's not just ChatGPT, right? I think Director March is such a techie. She uses other generative AI tools, right? She even has, what do you call this, Director March, when you come home, they answer you? Very, very tech enabled. Anyway, so I was asking,
Google Assistant.
She has a Google Assistant. And the Google
There's another one which is Alexa, but I just have my Google Assistant.
So when you ask the questions, only you can ask those questions. Even Ron, when he asks questions, his line of question is very different from mine. And therefore, the answer is mine. So in that sense, whatever you get, if you don't just lift it like what you said, you don't lift it word per word, it's not plagiarism.
It's yours.
This is going to be a long discussion if you want
yes,
to go
it's
there.
It's a long debate, Ron.
That is a long debate, but I think the issue is we should be talking about it now. Is this a conversation that's already happening?
We have started already. I don't want to mention, but today there was a launch of an AI sportscaster, if you're very much aware. In the United States, we have the Writers Guild of America and mm-hmm. even, you know, the Actors Guild, because AI is actually creeping in into the job. Not just creeping in, it's actually displacing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think in the matter of industry and preparing our students, that should be a discussion. Not just, you know, academic integrity. A while ago, I was saying, that will be a very long discussion because we have a definition of, you know, plagiarism, lifting. But what if you don't lift it? What if you just converse with ChatGPT? Because ChatGPT does not present itself as really a source of information. You can see ChatGPT as a co-learner, mm-hmm. a tutor, for mm-hmm. example. Mm-hmm. So when I usually give a talk, and director knows this because this is always one thing that I ask, do you ask the kids or the students to cite their tutors or maybe the parents when they're sharing ideas? Yeah. Because if ChatGPT works that way, should we then cite ChatGPT?
That would be a funny footnote. Yeah. My father, Ron Cruz, said.
Footnote one, yeah.
And we never do that, right?
Yeah,
it's because we trust that there is this exchange of information. So there are different ways into looking at, you know, generative AI, ChatGPT in terms of usage. Mm-hmm. But I like what Director Marge said. It's already there. Mm-hmm. Should we learn how to live with AI or generative AI? So those are the questions that we need to ask.
So Director Marge, I know that the DepEd is maybe still focusing right now on the pilot testing of the Matatag curriculum. But do you see it in the near future that the Department of Education will also, or is it starting already now or planning on how to teach students how to use AI, most specifically generative AI?
Actually, Rom, it's not actually it's not really focusing on whether or not we teach the use of AI, but there is already the integration and the use of technology. And as Jim has said, we need to work on the baseline, which is really working on the use, on how to use the tools. Mm-hmm. And to use the tools would mean we have to prepare students to get to embrace what technology can do and should be doing as they go through the learning process. With the curriculum, with the K-12 curriculum, I do understand the technology integration is already present.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of going into the nitty-gritty details of that, as a teacher, how do you know if the student is using ChatGPT in the right way or not? Because you said earlier, there's a right way to use it and there's a wrong way to do it.
Well, there are also AI that detects other AI, but it's the case right now is the burden of proof is actually on the teacher, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes AI detectors fail. They're not 100% sure. So in the end, we would say, you know your students.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a student who submitted a perfect A plus A paper, but you know actually that this student
historically,
struggles historically or maybe not historically, but in terms of evidences of learning, then that's a red flag, a warning for you. But then you need to be careful because the burden of proof is actually with you,
right?
So again, I think my take really in terms of this is because we don't want us policing, like we have a lot of students.
Mm-hmm.
Our main goal is to know our students so that we know where they are in terms of literacy skills or numeracy skills.
Oh my gosh, the teacher to student ratio in public schools in Xavier.
Mm-hmm. So, but for me, I think the final thing there is, aside from teaching the tools, I think it's about teaching as well values.
Mm-hmm.
I also handle the values formation, curriculum in Xavier, and that's what I love about my job. You can get to marry tech and values. Mm-hmm. In the end, technology will change. We don't know what technology will come in, but if we've set those values and skills in mind of the students, I think that's one way of preparing them for the future.
Mm-hmm. Director Marge, I just have a couple of questions about we had Undersecretary Den Singh facing, I think it was a budget defense, when he mentioned that the DepEd is looking into tapping AI into addressing the problem of classroom shortage. Can you give us more information about that? How and when will it be used?
Oh, well, sorry, Rom. I did not hear when USEC was talking about that. But surely with the advent of AI, and of course, as mentioned by Jim, the basis really is to teach our students on how to make use of all of these tools Well, of course, with the technology integration in the curriculum, that will help them somehow develop their skills. But as to the using of the AI to either augment the classroom shortage, that's one thing that we should look into. But for now, that is not yet a priority, because our priority really at this point in time is for our students really to get to learn, not just to get to learn the basic tools in the, with the, when it comes to the use of technology, and eventually going into with the aid of AI that would facilitate learning in the classroom and even outside the classroom realm.
Yeah, I think the external partnership service, which is partners with a lot of different corporations, right, to reduce the classroom shortage.
Yeah, that will be able to with do the partners.
More than the AI.
Yeah, with the partners, they will help us build more classrooms and provide more classrooms for us for the students to make use of together with the teachers. But at this point in time, it's not going to be AI yet.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. It's just such a short time for this conversation. We haven't even talked about your Global Teacher Prize effort
yeah.
to be able to be the first, your first time to join in this.
Yeah, I was the first finalist,
finalist.
From the Philippines. Uh-huh. But we have a lot of amazing teachers now who also broke through throughout the years representing our country.
Wow, thank you so much, Jim.
Thank you
for the work you do.
Thank you,
Director Marge.
Thank you, Salve and Rom.
Thanks.